Welcome to the Powerful Voices Speaker Series and the New Grand Challenges Forum. I am Dr. Christine Laveau-Haley from the Honors College. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Robert Nicol. Robert Nicol is the Senior Director of Technology Development at the Broad Institute of MIT and Harvard. He is also co-founder of the MIT Broad Foundry for Synthetic Biology. An engineer focused on solving biomedical research challenges, Robert Nicol leads a research laboratory at the Broad Institute focused on creating new technologies for DNA sequencing, DNA synthesis, and therapeutic development. Dr. Nicol brings a diverse, multidisciplinary background to creating biomedical technologies, including mechanical, chemical, systems and business engineering across a career spanning work in petrochemicals, aerospace, and biotechnology. Dr. Nicol worked in petrochemical engineering for Fluor Daniel after he got his BS in mechanical engineering from the University of Houston, starting as a fluid dynamics simulation engineer and working his way up to project manager, leading large-scale petrochemical processing, engineering, and construction projects for firms in the United States, Russia, and South America. After 7 years at the firm, he decided to go back to school. He enrolled at MIT and refocused his career toward biotechnology with degrees in chemical and systems engineering. At MIT, Dr. Nicol was also a Leaders for Manufacturing Fellow, where he also worked on production line optimization for Raytheon's advanced medium-range air-to-air missile and Boeing's 777. Nicol joined the Whitehead Institute, MIT Center for Genome Research in 2001 to apply industrial process design to genome sequencing and directed the sequencing operations and technology development groups at the Broad for over 12 years, designing and implementing multiple generations of high-throughput DNA sequencing processes. Dr. Nicol is also the co-founder of multiple biotechnology companies. He received his BS in mechanical engineering from the University of Houston and an MS in chemical engineering, MBA and PhD in engineering systems from MIT. Please help me welcome Dr. Robert Nicol.
Thank you, Christine. It's an honor to be here and virtually. As much as I'd like to actually be in Houston right now, we were chatting about getting some Tex-Mex after, which sounds amusing. I've prepared some slides for this that I think will illustrate my career and in biology. But mostly, what I like to do, I think, is, as I understand, it's mostly students on the line. It's really an exhortation to join this wave of biotechnology that is just coming. That there are so many opportunities in across almost every discipline in biotechnology. I think I'm a good example of it in the sense that I actually didn't like biology as an undergrad. In high school, the way it was taught was very memorization based. And as kind of an engineer, even then, I liked the ability to understand things, to be able to build things with the tools. And so biology at the time really kind of wasn't quite there. And it took some time before some of these tools were ready and available to the point that we'll talk about it in this talk today. How I got here a little bit is my parents had moved to Houston the University of Houston offered me this amazing scholarship to go to school there. So I enrolled in the Honors College, which I think is, any of you in the Honors College should feel very proud to be there. It's an amazing experience, and I think certainly comparable to any other school that you could attend. I think you should really cherish that experience. And so I did mechanical engineering. Mostly, as some of these things will go, is I had this amazing professor that really inspired me. His name is Keith Hollingsworth. He's moved on from U of H since, but he taught thermodynamics, and I really loved that course. And because I got along so well with him, I decided to stay with mechanical engineering. Went through the courses, actually started on, had even started on a PhD in mechanical engineering with the idea to eventually be an aerospace engineer. And that was mostly cut short because I had put in my resume in the resume book. At the time, you still had resume books. And this petrochemical engineering company named Fleur Daniel picked it up and called me and offered me a position. And it was just an amazing opportunity. They also, at the time, was very, very well paid. And so as a young engineer, I decided to take it and didn't continue my aerospace career. But it was an amazing opportunity. I joined them. Fleur Daniel is a engineering company that if you need a refinery, if you need an offshore oil platform, that's who you call. And worked on projects all over, worked in Russia, worked in South America. And really, it provided this, you might ask, well, what's the connection between petrochemicals to now biotech? Petrochemical engineering is very multidisciplinary. It's chemical engineering to understand the refinery parameters, mechanical engineering to design all of the pumps and systems, electrical engineering. And you have to integrate all of that together to make a system work. All of the systems that we use in modern biotechnology are of the same type. They're very multidisciplinary. They're chemical engineering, computer engineering. And that background actually served me very well as I went forward in my career. After working a few years in petrochemicals with this company, I decided to go back to graduate school and applied to various schools, and among them MIT, which to an engineer is it's hard to it's a place you'd want to go to. So I decided to go there, and while there, I did a master's of chemical engineering, PhD, engineering systems, and MBA. Around the time, while I was working on all that, MIT was also, the MIT Whitehead Center for Genome Research was doing a good part of what, of the Human Genome Project. And so there was a position open for somebody who would have an industrial background to really build a factory that would produce all of the sequencing and all of the, basically the Human Genome Project, which was really about industrializing these, what to that point had been very lab bench, sort of scientists working at a lab bench, to really industrialize it. And so I took on that job and continued there. The institute then became this, what's called the Broad Institute today, which is this large multidisciplinary research institute where my laboratory is now. And so that's my career. The talk today is really all about this idea. So reading and writing DNA. And this idea is simple, but very powerful, right? So within every cell, you have the instructions to make that cell. You have DNA that encodes for all of the parts, all of the things that make up the cell. And so that's these letters, the C, T, G, A. And so the purpose of the Human Genome Project for a long time was about reading and extracting that information. And now with the, you know, more advanced technologies that we've been able to develop, it's all about writing DNA. So now that we're able to read and decode that DNA, we can now write it and actually program cells to do all sorts of different things. You might ask, well, why should we care, right? Why is this important? Well, the reason that I'm excited, and I hope that you will be as well, is that biology is really technology. If you think about biology, right, it's this simple set of building blocks from which you can build essentially everything. It's programmable, so you have the genetic code. You really should think about it as a programming language. It's able to do large-scale manufacturing. Think about a forest. That's how it's able to replicate itself and produce copies of each design. And it operates at these very, you know, massively different length scales, from nanometers, the molecules that are that make up your body, to cells, to trees, going from, you know, nanometers all the way to, you know, tens of meters. And so it's a really unique and powerful technology and engineering tool. And you know, it's been right, and companies and the economy has started to take notice that you can actually use this as a technology. And so being able to decode and extract the rules, you can now apply them. You can now start to make parts for aircraft, even out of biological processes. The impact on the economy is growing, and it will continue to grow. It's already, you know, quite large. In areas, traditional areas, certainly crops and being able to engineer and produce better foods, but biologics, so many of the drugs that they will take and so on. And now a growing part of this is the industrial applications of actually being able to make materials and make components of the economy. And so one way to think about this is there's this economic theory that it's called the Kondratiev wave. And the basic concept of it is that you, stemming from fundamental discoveries, that you do the fundamental discoveries, and then as you start to apply them, you get better and better. You get applied technologies from these fundamental discoveries, and then as the performance of these things tapers off, you get a new wave of new discoveries, and that supplants the previous. And this is again one economic theory, but you can think of sort of things like steel, electricity, and the Industrial Revolution. Petrochemicals and the discoveries of how to manufacture and engineer oil and make it into plastics, the, you know, quantum mechanics and being able to understand semiconductors and develop semiconductors, and now that led to electronic information age. And I would argue that many of the discoveries that were made in the late 20s, 30s, basically most of the last 50 to 100 years, are now powering kind of this next wave that will be biological. And so, okay, that all sounds good. Why, you know, why isn't this happening faster? And part of the reason is biology is still very hard. Biology is, it's simple building blocks, but they can be arranged in all sorts of unique combinations, and the number of permutations, combinations of these things is absolutely enormous. These are, you know, pathways that exist in cells. And the comparison that I want to make as a, you know, chemical engineer and so on, and electrical, is that for all of these disciplines, you have the basic design rules. So you understand the performance of a chemical reactor. You understand the performance of an aircraft wing. We have simulation tools, quite advanced ones. And we can build in, we have substantial supply chains that can provide all of these parts. In in bioengineering, we're not there yet. We're working on it, but we're not there yet. And so we're kind of starting on this wave where the fundamental, you know, technologies and discoveries have been made, but we're starting to get on this implementation. I think it should be a very exciting opportunity for all of the students on the call to think about how to join in on this wave. Let me step back and I'll walk a little bit through my career and how I became to be such a convert. Again, not as a undergrad necessarily loving biology, but you know, let's talk about Human Genome Project and what that means. So Human Genome Project, one of you sitting at home or in your dorms or offices, one human being is on the order of 10 to 30 trillion cells, right? And so in each of those cells are 23 pairs of chromosomes, 3 billion bases roughly of DNA per copy. And that's equivalent to about 1,000 textbooks, right? The reason the Human Genome Project was important was that up until that point, we really didn't have maps. We didn't have, this is a map of Boston. We didn't know where things were. It was just a list of all sorts of different things, but of different proteins and different parts, but we didn't know where the university was, where was the center, where was the airport. And that's some of the core of what the Human Genome Project was, is to basically produce a map that was a lay of the land of our genome. And so on the right on your screens is this map. And so these are the various chromosomes with, in this case, what's been highlighted, these little letters next to them, are genes associated with cancer. And here is an example of one where I've expanded this. And here are these are pages of the letters, the ATCG code, the genetic code that constitute this particular human gene, that when you have damage, when you have a change in one letter in that gene, it can become damaged, and this one is implicated in 90% of all over 90% of all lung cancers. And so this was the interest of doing the human genome is to produce the map of our own cells. And from those technologies, then you can apply it to all sorts of things. So for example, the COVID virus, the COVID-19 is 29,000 bases. It's very small, but it encodes for this instructions to make this particular, virus. And using the same types of technologies, the same types of maps, we can understand where the critical portions of this virus are, and better understand how to deal with it. And since then, there's been this massive investment in genomics, because understanding the genomics, these maps, allows you to really start to understand biology in our own cells as more of an engineering system, which is what my motivation was. And so again, if you think of yourselves as a human being, is about 37 trillion cells, and yet the immune system, so the part that is responsible for recognizing when you get a vaccine, for recognizing a virus that infects you, is a small portion of that. It's 0.1 trillion cells that are in your body that are associated with the immune system. You're producing about 0.01 trillion cells per day. And this is what, when we get a vaccine, these are the cells that then are responsible for recognizing and basically reading and responding to that vaccine so that you can generate our immune response. And so following Human Genome Project, we needed to now delve into not just the genetic code, but now understanding organisms at the cellular level and understanding how our own bodies are made and are the composition of them. And so, for example, in addition to your own cells, your 37 trillion cells that make you up, you are inside of your gut and your stomach, covered on your skin, you're covered with over 100 trillion cells of microbes. Now, these are not bad things. These are hardworking microbes that are there to help you, mostly. But we coexist with them every day, and they're again, the majority of them are perfectly harmless. But they help us digest, so we couldn't eat a lot of the foods that we have without these microbes. Of course, when they get out of whack, when you have more of one or the other or different ones, they can lead to disease. Other areas. So for example, you might ask, well, if we have 37 trillion cells, how is it that my skin cells are different than muscle cells, are different than the cells in the retina of my eye? And the reason is that on top of the DNA, you have this whole other control layer, another control system that is called epigenetics, that basically is what controls the turning on and off of each of the genes in your cells. And in this example, when, you know, 3-year-old twins, they have essentially all of their switches of their genes turned on in exactly, essentially the same way. But as they age and one of them leads a very healthy life, the other one maybe doesn't exercise as much, doesn't eat as well, there starts to be differences in how the progression of these genes turn on and evolve. And so you can see now that these two identical twins now have their, think of it as switches again, in very different positions and different settings, and that can lead to different diseases. And the reason to walk you through some of that, some of those ideas, is that the way that me and others and are thinking about it is that biology should really be closer to the way that we think about aircraft or any engineered system that we can build and design. For example, the latest 787, the Boeing large jetliner. This aircraft has within it all sorts of sensors that continuously are measuring the oil pressure on the engines, the amount of current that's in the electrical system. It's continuously being monitored. And they're able to do that, and they're able to, as it's flying, if it detects any issue when it lands, mechanics can then replace parts way in advance of anything going wrong. They can do that because they fundamentally understand the engineering of the system in ways that we don't quite yet have for our own bodies, but we're getting there, and that's the purpose of a lot of this. A lot of these projects is to get closer to engineering type knowledge of being able to have similar level of control and preventive maintenance for our own bodies. And that's what we're trying to get to. In order to get to that level of engineering and knowledge, we need to be able to generate a lot of data. And so over the last, since the last 20, 30 years of DNA sequencing, for example, to be able to read that DNA inside of cells, there's been this incredible decrease in the cost of sequencing through generations of technology, just massive investments. And again, it's so that we can then decode more and more cells and organisms and get to that level of engineering knowledge. And so here's a curve of showing what the cost was and the cost decrease of sequencing per million bases. And so back at the sort of human genome project days, it was, you know, in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, and now it's in the dollar range, which is amazing. If you think about, you know, any other technology that has decreased that quickly, basically cars would be free, essentially nearly free, if they had improved at the same rate. But of course, it takes a long time to develop these technologies. So this is, you know, the timeline, right? That it took a long time, lots of fundamental discoveries from the Nobel Prize for the discovery of DNA sequencing in 77 to 1977 to Frederick Sanger to it took 30, 40 years for this this technology to really mature. And it's again this idea of these waves, these economic waves, that it takes some time from the fundamental discovery to the time that you actually have the application and the actual implementation of these technologies. And so here's example, largely from our own lab, and this is it's a picture of the lab that I was hired to run and do the technology development for at MIT. This is a picture of us back in the towards the end of the Human Genome Project, and this is this cost curve of the cost per genome, and this spectacular decrease in cost. And again, the reason that we want and push for this cost decrease is so that the more data that we can gather for more people, the better our understanding of the engineering system. So if we only sequence one person, we can't really say that much about what it is that might cause or might not cause a disease within them. But if, for example, we take 10,000 patients with a given disease, we can really understand what are their genetic differences and what are the genetic variants that then really contribute to that disease state. And I want to emphasize down here that to make this happen, to make this cost decrease happen, took a lot of different technologies. It took automation, it took robots being built with teams of electrical engineers and computer software folks. It took biologists and molecular biologists. It took physicists and optical engineers to build the sequencers. It's a very multidisciplinary effort. And so I could say that basically any major of any of the students listening to this talk, you can participate in modern biotechnology from basically every single dimension. There's a need for literally every discipline to make this all happen. And again, if you think about, you know, at the start of this, what, you know, this was a Nokia phone from that era compared to, you know, maybe the phones that you're perhaps watching this on, it's nothing really has improved to this level. And again, here are some pictures from back in the day of the types of technologies that we were using, which were just outrageously primitive to compare to today. So one of these sequencers, basically this entire room is now, which ran 24/7, is now made obsolete by a small tabletop sequencer that we have in the lab today. And you know, you think about things that were high tech in that, you know, back then it was something like the iPod Nano, Gmail had just been rolled out. Again, just to ground you in sort of the level of technology. Here's a picture from a more modern sequencer and the different parts that make it up. And again, I'm just emphasizing the multidisciplinary nature of it, that once you peel the covers off one of these systems, there is a very serious optical system with pumps and control systems. And so there's teams of electrical engineers and computer scientists and mechanical engineers and material scientists that are needed to make these instruments work and happen. And so certainly, as you're thinking of careers after graduation, take a look at the certainly any of the biotechnology companies. There's I think you'll find that many of them will have a need for any of the disciplines that you're in. Here's a picture of one of these flow cells that are inside of the instrument that are, so basically inside each of these flow cells, you have DNA inside, and this is what you're actually sequencing. You amplify little snippets of DNA to be able to read it. But this is technology borrowed from semiconductor manufacturing, where they've basically taken semiconductor type systems and adapted them to biology. And this is just a recurring theme throughout all of modern biotechnology, is the repurposing of technologies from one discipline to the next. Of course, we're not, we're far from being able to just solve all of this. And so to, while sequencing of the individual DNA inside of cells is important, we're made of these many, many trillions of cells. And in the case of cancer, what happens is that the tumors are actually very heterogeneous. So it's not, a cancer tumor is not the same type of cell that just expands, but they actually, as they're expanding, they mutate and they change. And so what we'd like to be able to do is really have technologies that can isolate individual cells and tell us what's going wrong inside each one of them or why they're different. And so one of the technologies that, has been developed in my lab and other labs, of course, is technologies to be able to assay individual cells at really extreme throughput. And so one of the technologies is, we'll take assay plates, these plastic assay plates where you do these biochemical assays that are macro scale, you can hold it in your hand, but then we miniaturize it into these picoliter and nanoliter scale engineered droplets, where again we borrow from semiconductor technologies to basically make these tiny little emulsion droplets inside of which we place, we can isolate individual cells, and then we can sort based on different characteristics to be able to assay these very heterogeneous cells and get to, you know, what are the difference between individual cells. Out of my lab and other collaborator labs, we've commercialized some of these technologies. One of them in a company called Hi-Fi Bio, and another one in a company called BioMillennia. Hi-Fi Bio, what they do is, and what they both do, but Hi-Fi Bio specifically, is able to take these individual cells from the immune system, isolate them, and identify differences between them. And you might ask, well, why is that important? And that's important because, for example, when you are exposed to a virus, let's say the, COVID virus, and you survive the virus, some of those cells basically encode and, have within them the instructions for the antibody that is that protects you against the virus. And so using this technology, we're able to then scan through survivor blood and isolate the cells that carry that protective antibody and isolate that and generate a drug from that. And, so our company, as part of being good citizens and, responding to the pandemic, we adapted our technologies, which are were mainly prior to the pandemic focused on developing cancer therapeutics, to develop, to identify basically the protective antibodies from patients and, make those into a therapeutic, make those into a drug. And so we are currently doing starting clinical trials for a therapeutic antibody that we identified in that way. And so how this would be given is for at-risk patients or frontline workers or other vulnerable populations where you could provide that to the patients and they would be protected for some period of time against the virus. So let me switch gears a little bit, and I think we're still have some time. To go back to this idea of DNA as information, and again, within the cells is a nucleus in mammalian cells. You have chromosomes. You then have DNA that's wrapped around, and these chromosomes wrapped around proteins. But another way to think about that DNA is literally as a computer code, just like ones and zeros, just like what exists in your computer. And so each of the letters in the DNA code, you can represent as a binary computer code, as 00 for A, 11 for T, 01 for G, 10 for C, and so on. And using that encoding, you can essentially encode anything that is currently stored in a computer. You could encode it back into DNA. So for example, the opening line from Moby Dick, "Call me Ishmael," is here represented as zeros and ones in a computer, can also be represented as this string of letters in DNA. And that's important and that's interesting because DNA is the original disk drive. DNA is the original way to store information. That's its purpose, is to record all of the evolutionary experiments, right? The DNA that we carry within us is essentially a lab notebook of billions of years of experiments, of which ones worked and which ones didn't, recorded in DNA. And so it's really been perfected as this really fantastic way to store data that can be easily copied. We have ways that we can copy it enzymatically. It's very stable chemically, and it's very compact. It's extraordinarily compact. And so within a tiny tube, you could literally, if you were able to print all of the world's data, you could store all of the planet's data inside of tube of DNA. And that matters because we're producing a lot of data, right? So 2019, the estimate is about 33 zettabytes. 2025, the estimate is 175 zettabytes. And some of this is being driven by just the devices that we're making. So each of the autonomous cars, right, they have multiple cameras, the self-driving cars, they're generating 4 terabytes per day just from high definition video that they have to collect as they're driving. And so if you can imagine in the future, a fleet of 500 million vehicles each producing 4 terabytes per day, that's 2 exabytes per day. That's more than that, you know, 2 exabytes per day, that's more than Facebook produces in a year right now. And so we need ways to be able to store this amount of data. And DNA, while it might not be as fast as hard disk drives or solid state drives, it is a great way to archive things, or could be. And so my lab is working on technologies using some of the properties of DNA and the ways in which it is synthesized in nature to be able to store that. And so we recently received a large award to be able to do this and be able to generate systems to be able to store DNA in this way. Let me switch gears a little bit to say, well, if you can write DNA, that means you should be able to program, right? If you can write text, you should be able to program. And so another part of our lab is doing exactly that, in that if you think about any organism, so microbes or yeast, inside of them is this DNA, which really is a computer program, it's instructions. And so another name for that is, you know, biosynthetic gene clusters, which is really the instruction set for making molecules. And so using the sequencing technologies that I've told you about, we're able to read that out, but then also modify it and identify interesting molecules that might be useful. Some of them are, for example, antibiotics that are we're quickly running out of, and so there's a lot of interest for discovering new ones, but also all sorts of other interesting molecules. Some of them, for example, one great example is this molecule artemisinin, which is an anti-malarial that grows in this plant, Artemisia annua, which, and so you could grow a lot of these plants. They're slow growers, or it takes some time to grow. They're difficult to extract this molecule from them. And so it'd be very expensive, never mind the cost to environment to farm all of these things to crop to in crops. And so ideally what we'd be able to do is grow a lot of this, because the burden, the disease burden of malaria is very significant. And it's very significant in third world countries, where they're also the people in those countries, can't afford expensive therapeutics. And so ideally what we'd want to do is find a way to produce this very cheaply. Like, oh, for example, if you could produce it in the same way that you produce beer, you could just ferment, throw in some yeast and let the yeast just divide and produce this via fermentation. And so this is what one of the, I think, success stories for biotechnology in the recent times is the ability to basically, what they did is they extracted the biosynthetic pathway to produce this, basically the genes and enzymes that produce this in this plant, and were able to transfer that into yeast to produce it at scale and very efficiently. And so we need more of this, and more is coming, but this is kind of one of the early examples. This one was, one of the first ones, was expensive to do, but we hope to get better at this, and that's some of the future. And some of the reasons that, we're not yet there and we can't do this routinely and cheaply is that the biology is still very complex, as I mentioned before, that cells have evolved to have their own particular purpose, and we're trying to kind of hijack some of that machinery to be able to engineer things. And so we're learning the rules, we're getting better, but there's still a lot of rule engineering that we need to do. And the basis of this rule, this set of tools that we're building is built around these disciplines of computer science, engineering, molecular biology, chemistry, to build this new set of biological tools. And so what we're after, and one of my great friends and colleagues' quote here is really we're after is the ability to engineer systems the same way that we can engineer these amazing aircraft, bridges. Here's the Houston skyline. We understand these systems really well. We know the parameters. We can tweak them. We're not quite there yet with biology, but we're working on it. To kind of wrap up a little bit, if you think about this is some of the grand challenges that the MIT Technology Review magazine put forth that technology could solve, and this is 2019. So, what were some of the challenges that they felt that technology would be especially well suited and was really critical that they address? So. Things like energy efficient desalination to provide water to especially to poor countries. Earthquake prediction, we can predict, although certainly hurricanes are an issue and we need better ways to deal with them. We can better plan for them because we have satellites, we can forecast them. Earthquakes occur fairly suddenly. ocean cleanup, that so much of our waste is going into oceans, and we need to better ways to clean that up. We need ways to store all of the green energy sources, solar and wind. We need ways to store them as batteries, right? So that when there's no wind or there's no sun, we can still draw on that on the batteries to power our homes and factories. Being able to decode our brain and how it works. This was obviously pre-2019, but they did point out that a universal flu vaccine would be great. Of course, the COVID vaccine is now in a similar vein. Embodied AI, so actual AI type robots, dementia treatment, just the burden of Alzheimer's as our population ages will be more and more. Carbon sequestration for obviously climate change and how that will impact in driverless cars is, again, these were just some of the ones that they postulated as really critical challenges. And if you think about ones in which biology could, or biotechnology could really make a difference, it's a lot, right? So energy efficient desalination, are there ways to produce membranes or other biologically assisted ways to purify that water? Of course, vaccines, better treatments for Alzheimer's and dementia, better ways to capture carbon. There are biological methods that are being used to develop batteries where the biology helps make battery components that are produce higher performing batteries. Enzymes that can chew up all of the plastics and things that we're dumping into the ocean and can allow us to recycle them and brain decoding. All of these things are things that this modern biotechnology, this multidisciplinary biotechnology can tackle. And there are things that you can and should participate in. And I challenge you to think about, as you think about your careers, to look at ways to participate in these challenges. Again, let me wrap up and say thank you to University of Houston and the Honors College for giving me that foundation on which, you know, everything I've talked here has been built. Thank you to all of you for listening, and thank you for certainly considering this path and what I think is this, you know, again, amazing opportunity for all of you to participate in this world. And go Cougs. So yeah, let me end there and maybe see if there's any questions from the students.
Thank you so much. So interesting. All of it is fascinating. We have several questions. I have to say that the Dean of the Honors College is on the call, and he is just gushing right now. He's so excited to hear you, talking about your experience in the Honors College. So we are thrilled that you are here. Okay, there are a couple of questions, and I wanted to get to a couple of them. So this is Colton Baker, and I am studying mathematics and data science here at the University of Houston, and I'm interested in biological applications. You had mentioned the Human Genome Project and its role in bioengineering, but could you briefly describe, in your opinion, the effect of finalizing the human proteome project will have specifically for bioengineering in the coming decades, and how do you think it will impact the industry economically?
Yeah, so first of all, mathematics is core to everything I've talked about, the algorithms that then power the bioinformatics and the being able to treat biology as data as a mathematician, you would find lots of opportunities, I think, in this field. The proteome specifically, if you think about the central dogma of biology, so it's DNA to RNA to proteins expression. It is the next step that we need to tackle in terms of mapping all of the proteins and all of the, right, there's DNA, but what you actually interact with are proteins. So the you know, your skin and your cells, it's, those are three-dimensional structures, proteins. The challenge is that if you think about in a mathematics way, that you have DNA as polymer, so that's a sequence of letters. Proteins now have a three-dimensional structure, and so the space, the number of permutations of those structures is enormously larger and much harder to read. So it's going to take some time and lots of clever technologies to be able to do something equivalent to the genome project for proteomes. But we're on our way, and it's certainly the next step. It's just it's a really hard problem that I hope you as a mathematician will join in to help solve.
Thank you. This is from Beverly Sadler. Would the chemical engineering or biology be the major to pursue in order to enter the study of human genome?
Absolutely. Yeah, chemical engineering biology, that's, you're on the right path already. I think the, as I kind of emphasized, almost any of the, engineering disciplines, science disciplines has an application in this space. Chemical engineering and biology, of course, are that much closer. A lot of it is to the extent that you can take some additional courses to fill out your knowledge of, take a bioinformatics course, especially biology, biochemistry, so that it's not just organic chemistry, but that you also take some biochemistry. That's important as well.
Next question. I would like to know more about the memory capability of immunity cells and what we know today about this.
So I'm interpreting the question, but if you think about your immune system, so we have two types of immune systems. We have an innate immune system that we're born with, and we have what's called the adaptive immune system. And so the innate immune system, as you're born, is kind of your kind of a first pass system that recognizes certain foreign organisms like microbes and things. It's very coarse, but as you for example have the flu, or you have certain immunizations, each exposure then gets your immune system, the adaptive immune system, is able to, in a way, remember those exposures in these B cells among, right? And so your body is able to store that information, so that when, after your immunization, when you're then exposed to the actual virus or microbe, it can then mount a response. But it stores that information as a set of cells in these memory B cells. You can quantify in terms of the amount of information that they contain. But it's a finite resource, which is a reason you need to get booster shots for vaccines and things like that. It's not something that is, as permanent as a hard, as a disk drive on your phone. It's something that is, it's long lasting, but is somewhat temporary.
This is a question from, it's a question. This is from Bill Monroe. Rob, this is Bill Monroe.
Hey, Bill.
A bit off topic, but maybe not. Do you remember the professors you had for your human situation discussion sections?
So there's immune memory cells, and then there's regular memory cells, and I guess so I will say that they were all great. And I think Bill might have been actually one of them.
Okay. So,
I'm going to say that was.
We'll let you off the hook. Yeah. We'll let you off the hook on that. We have one more question, I think, and then we'll wrap it up if you don't mind. Let's see. Okay, so at what point? Okay, there's two questions. Okay, at what point in your career did you decide to pursue MIT? And then I'm going to ask this one, you can answer. But and what was there a transfer of skills from your prior career in petrochemical to your current work? Two different questions.
Yeah. So I had gone undergrad to UH. I started on a PhD, but then got this kind of very well-paid job offer to go to this petrochemical engineering company, where it was a fantastic experience. I mean, the projects were all overseas, so I got to work in all sorts of interesting places. I didn't feel that what I was doing day to day, the engineering. If you think about the engineering of petrochemicals, it's designed to be extremely conservative because you want things to be extraordinarily reliable and not have to be, you don't need things that are on the cutting edge, you need reliability. And I really wanted to be doing things that were really gonna be pushing the envelope, really kind of, you know, doing really advanced technology development, and so that was my main motivation to apply for graduate school, and so I applied to various graduate schools. MIT was kind of mecca for engineers, so it's hard to turn that down. The other question, Christine,
dealt with where did it go?
Petrochemical, how did it prepare me for? So because again, petrochemicals is this extremely multidisciplinary. When you build the offshore platforms that we would build or the refineries, you needed to bring together chemical engineering, civil engineering, electrical engineering, every engineering. And economics as well, of course. You had to then also deliver everything within budget. And that sort of, which is, I think, I will say that is much more of a feature of engineering education, more so than it is perhaps some of the hard sciences. The emphasis on team building and putting things together and that all these things need to work together was actually a great preparation for the type of biotechnology that I do now, because we are having to develop these systems that include semiconductors and molecular biology and computer science, and being able to do that systems integration is really key.
All right. Thank you very much. I wish that everyone could kind of clap with me to thank you for the talk. It was excellent, informative, inspiring, absolutely for our University of Houston students. When we have someone like you talking to them, they know the sky's the limit. So thank you so much, Dr. Robert Nicol. I'll get the hand clap for all the rest of the people on the call. Thank you very much. Have a great evening and good night.
Thank you.